Have you ever felt like combat in D&D is boring and lacks spice? Well, today I'm going to show you how to run incredible combat in 5th edition. This video is sponsored by Kibble's Compendium of Craft and Creation, now on Kickstarter. More on them later. Greetings gamers, I'm Anto and I'm an Eldritch Blast addict, and today I'm going to show you how you can turn any D&D combat from a slugfest where everyone stands in a line until someone dies into something exciting and cinematic. This is actually a topic I covered a couple of years ago, but I've always felt that video left out a lot of detail and only served as kind of the starting point for the discussion. I have a lot more to say on amazing combat, so I'm making this updated video. Now in this video we're going to talk about what makes combat boring, about how you can deploy some dynamic elements that will make your combat more interesting and fun, and then we're going to take the most boring combat possible in D&D, the bandit ambush, and I'm going to show you how you can apply your dynamic elements to turn that boring encounter into something amazing. So let's get started. So then, why is your combat boring? In my opinion, there are four main things that cause a combat encounter to be boring and forgettable. The first of these is that combat lacks any narrative weight. It doesn't further your story or develop your player characters or provide any information about your world. This is a common problem with kind of random encounters. Just throwing a few monsters at random at your party is rarely going to feel satisfying to you. The next thing that makes combat boring is flat terrain. An open room or an empty field is an incredibly dull location for a combat, and without other elements to kind of spice things up, your players are probably going to get quite bored. The next pillar of combat is using only one enemy type. If your players are fighting multiple enemies of the same monster, nothing interesting is being brought to the table by that. And the final thing that makes your combats a drag is that they devolve into a hit them until they're dead contest. The combat is won by hitting the enemies as hard as you can until they die. If you have a combat that has all four of these elements together, it is probably going to be a snooze fest for your players and probably for you to run as well. I think most of us are guilty of running combats like these, I know I certainly am, but fortunately it's easy to take your combats and elevate them to something epic. Now I think it's important to note here that not all combats need to be epic. If the purpose of your combat is to advance the story, reveal something about the players, or deliver information about the world, the combat itself doesn't need to be amazing. But I would say in that situation, when the combat isn't the focus of the scene and it's just there to communicate some information, you want to get the combat out of the way as quickly as possible, and we'll kind of talk about how you can do that a little later on. So then, what do we need to take a combat from everyone standing in a line and hitting each other until they die and turn it into something epic? We have a lot of tools that we can use to make combats more interesting, and you can add them to almost any combat to spice them up. The first thing that you want to establish is what are the goals, both for the enemy and for your players. A combat encounter is a challenge you put in front of the players, so you need to ask yourself, what challenge are you trying to present? From the point of view of the enemy is usually trying to kill the player characters, but why? Do they hate the PCs and want them dead no matter what? Or are they trying to prevent them from accomplishing something? If the players are attacking the enemy fortress, the guards are obviously trying to kill the player characters, but their actual goal is preventing the PCs from gaining access and killing their leader. Knowing the goals of everyone involved means that you can adjust your encounter based on those goals. The guards don't need to kill the players to deny them access to the fortress. If they were able to retreat and destroy the drawbridge, that would deny the player characters access in the short term, allowing the enemies to regroup. The next thing that you want to think about to make your combats more interesting is variety. If every enemy has the same stat block and is equipped with the same weapons, it's going to create a really flat encounter that leaves your players super bored. So try and use different enemy types to add variety. 4th edition actually had a pretty intuitive system for this concept, with each monster being assigned a role like minion or soldier, artillery, brute, and so on. By mixing in some artillery units that can deal rage damage, a brute that can soak up some of the party's physical damage, and maybe some skirmishers to take advantage of the terrain or get some precision strikes in, you can take combat from being boring to being something much more interesting. This is more difficult at early levels where there's less variety in monsters, and you know, adding too many extra enemies can really turn the tide of a battle fast. So what I recommend for early levels is give the monsters different weapons instead of changing their stat line. Skeletons, for example, have a short sword and a short bow, so instead of having them all run in with their swords, designate some of them to be artillery and use their bows from afar. Now, very closely tied to variety is using tactics and synergies to make your combats more interesting. In general, most things your players fight will either have the intelligence to use tactics, or they'll have the natural instincts to work in specific ways. Think of it like a pitched battle. On the surface, it's two lines of soldiers that walk up to each other and then hit each other until they die. But there are actually a lot more elements at play than that. First, the archers will try and thin the enemy lines, Then the spear phalanx forms a barrier for the enemy to break on before the swordsmen get in close. All the while, the skirmishers are harassing the enemy archers and cavalry are charging the exposed flanks. You want your monsters to achieve that level of tactical depth where it makes sense for them to do so. Multiple monster types, weapon types, and tactical positioning can make combat much more interesting. A good simple way to do this is have some of your enemies equipped with close range melee weapons, some equipped with reach weapons like glaives, and then some equipped with ranged weapons like bows or javelins. This allows the enemies to make the most of their weapons and be as effective as possible by fighting in those kind of tiered wave lines. You can also use multiple enemies that synergize well together. Instead of having the enemy wizard use bandits as fodder for the combat, perhaps they use a variety of animated objects. Animated armor to tank the damage, flying swords to attack the enemy, rugs of smothering to grapple the players to keep them from moving. This allows you to have a more mechanically interesting combat rather than just having a bunch of thugs and bandits, but it's also a lot more thematic for a kooky wizard who's animating everything around themselves to take part in the battle. Next up we have terrain, and terrain is another huge way that you can improve your combat. Think about it like this: if your party enter into a 20-foot square room and find a group of archers, that's an easy combat and the players would have no problems mopping those archers up. But if we take those same players and put them in an open waterlogged field and then take our archers and put them at the top of a hill with the sun at their back taking cover in the trees, that encounter plays out completely differently. The players have to struggle across the open field, slowed and with no cover, while the archers take shot after shot of them, whittling their HP down over multiple rounds. That's a pretty extreme example, but it does a great job of highlighting the importance of terrain and the environment in making your combat more interesting. If your combat is taking place outside, you can use weather, elevation, and scenery to change the conditions of the combat. A dense thicket of trees might make it easier for an enemy skirmisher to pass their stealth check and disappear from sight, only to pop up in a different position a few rounds later. A blanket of fog means ranged characters are at a serious disadvantage, and if the players are unfamiliar with the terrain and the enemies aren't, the enemies can escape easily, only to return moments later to deal that fatal blow. And for indoor combats, placing terrain in the room that the players can interact with can have a huge impact. Describing the bottles of alcohol on the table might prompt the player to throw one into the fire the enemy wizard has stood next to, while the fighter could kick the table over and give themselves cover against the enemy archers. The key for including terrain elements in your combat is to make sure to describe what's in the room, and if the players aren't utilizing the terrain, have the enemies use it as an example and a signal to the players that they can do this too. Having the enemies use the terrain is also a really good way to think more tactically with them as well. And that brings us nicely to the next thing you can do to make combat more fun, and that's to encourage your players' creativity and offer them new combat options. If you empower your players with the tools to do cool and interesting things, they'll make sure they never have a boring combat again because they will take the initiative. Perhaps the elf arcane archer needs to get down the stairs and the distance is long enough that under normal circumstances they would need to dash. Well, maybe you would allow them to use an enemy shield as a kind of board to ride down the stairs, have them make an acrobatics check to move the full distance of the stairs. If they want to fire their weapon while they're doing it, maybe they can make an acrobatics check that's at disadvantage. If you increase the amount that you say yes but to their interesting combat ideas, it will empower them to try new things. Sticking with the idea of giving power to the players here for a moment, I highly encourage you to get your players to narrate their attacks as they make them but before they roll their dice. I'm sure that most of us as Dungeon Masters will be pretty familiar with a situation where it comes to the end of a long session, you're feeling pretty burnt out on narrating combat and it devolves to, you hit it, he takes damage, yeah, that kills him. Having your players narrate their own attacks before the roll gives you that narrative fuel to make the combat more interesting. If a player say, I charge the orc and bring my great axe down in an overhead swing trying to cut the orc's head in two, and they roll the dice and miss, they've given you everything you need there to say you charge towards the orc, telegraphing your attack plainly as you draw your weapon back, and as you bring the axe down, the orc just sidesteps out the way of your attack. And then on the orc's turn, you can say, well, the orc sidesteps your swing, and as you bring your axe down fully, the orc targets your exposed flank, dealing 6 damage. This method helps get your players more engaged with the actions of the characters, which is great, but it also frees up some brain space for you. You don't have to provide as many descriptions and narrations, which means you can focus on other elements of running the combat. In the video I did on the house rules I use in my game, which you can see up here, I actually talked about this. I give my players a +2 anytime they narrate their attacks, they get a +2 to hit, which helps incentivize them to do this even more. And that brings us nicely to reactions and having the enemies react to the changing situation. It doesn't make sense for almost every enemy to charge the players and hit them until either they've died or the players have died. Unless they're mindless drones who have been ordered to kill, an enemy is going to react to the change in battle. If the enemy wizard gets taken out, for example, the other enemies in the battle might redirect their attacks to the party's spellcaster, as they don't have a foil for that anymore. If the enemy starts suffering heavy casualties, it's okay for them to flee or make a tactical retreat. In the majority of combat encounters, the enemy should fall back, reposition, or regroup if the battle starts to turn against them. One of the few situations in which they should fight for the last man is if they're defending something utterly vital to them, like a holy site or a group of civilians. But as that is typically something the players are more likely to do, have your enemies retreat. The enemy should also change their tactics in the middle of the battle as the situation changes. If a player goes down, this is a fantastic opportunity for the enemy to press their advantage. They can grab the downed player and force a parley, or deliver a swift coup de grace to take the combatant out of the fight. If the combat begins outside and the player casts fly, move the enemies inside where the player's flight isn't going to be as much of an advantage to them. If the enemy's trying to attack the party tank and just can't seem to land a blow, have them disengage and throw acid vials or cast AoE spells at the player who's unlikely to have the dexterity to get away from that. This is closely related to tactics, but focus more on responding to what the players are doing throughout the battle rather than just thinking kill, kill, kill. And then another thing you can deploy to make your fights more interesting are events or twists. The purpose of the event is to drastically change the circumstances of the combat or present a new element that can't be avoided. The players are fighting off the pirate raiders who are trying to board their ship when a kraken appears. The appearance of the kraken completely changes the combat and the players cannot continue as if nothing had happened. They have to change their tactics, reassess the battle, and adapt to this new twist. Halfway through the fight with the kraken, things are looking a little stale again, so maybe the kraken rips the player's ship in half, meaning they have to abandon ship and take the pirate ship that had come up alongside them. These events and twists are a great tool for you to add some extra spice to an otherwise mundane combat, and to bring the player's attention back to the center when things start to lag in the middle of a combat. Let's say your players are fighting a group of goblins that have taken over a castle. The fight so far has been pretty mundane, and it's lacking that wow factor. Well, perhaps one of the goblins can cut a chain holding a chandelier up, causing it to drop down and set the room on fire. A very goblin thing to do, but something that adds a new element to the battle that the players have to deal with. Finally, the last element I want to talk about to make your combats more memorable is narrative weight. One of the biggest things that can make your combat seem dull is a lack of narrative weight. If the players encounter a group of wolves in the woods as a random encounter, where's the narrative weight to that? What drama is being added by this encounter? Sure, the players could be killed, but that's an everyday risk for an adventurer, and it doesn't really add any extra drama. Without any narrative weight behind this, an encounter with the wolves is just going to feel like a slogfest waiting for their HP to be whittled away. So you want to do your best to make sure that every combat, no matter whether it's a random encounter or a boss battle, has some kind of narrative weight to it. Now, there are lots of ways that you can do this. Perhaps when the wolves attack, one of them is able to tear the player's bag from their back and runs off with it. Then it becomes a chase with the players trying to recover their goods instead of just a simple hit it until it's dead situation. Or perhaps instead of being outright attacked by the wolves, the players hear screams and find the wolves attacking someone else. Now they have drama, the players have to act quickly or the traveller will be killed by the wolves. We know the wolves probably won't kill the players, so it's hard to threaten them and make it dramatic, but an average citizen is almost certainly not going to be able to fight off a pack of wolves alone and unarmed. In a situation where the combat is a means to an end to communicate some other information or story beat, you want to move on from the combat as soon as it gets bogged down and starts to hinder the narrative. You can narrate the rest of the combat like a cutscene, have the enemies retreat, or lower the HP of the enemies so that instead of lasting 5 to 6 rounds, they only last 1 to 2 more rounds. Hi there! Before we go to my example of how to make the most boring combat ever seem something really exciting and fun, I just want to encourage you to subscribe if you haven't already. Only about 20% of you are currently subscribed, and I know we can get those numbers up. It's my goal this year to hit a total of 25,000 subscribers and build this community even more, and I need your help to do it. So if you enjoy what you see, click the subscribe button. Thanks! I love you. Now, a little while ago, I asked you folks what the most boring combat you could think of was. And to finish off today, I'm going to take one of the most common suggestions, the bandit ambush, and use the methods we've talked about here to turn it from boring into epic. I think most of us have probably run or played something similar to the boring bandit attack. Players are traveling on the road and they're stopped by some individuals who want to rob them or charge them some kind of tax to pass. Conversation is short and usually combat feels inevitable from the moment the bandits appear. Once the combat begins, everyone kind of lines up and hits each other until one side is completely dead, and then the players move on. not changed in any way or not made better or worse by the situation. So how do we make a bandit ambush more dramatic and memorable? Well, to start with, we want to think about what narrative purpose does our encounter serve and what's the goal of the characters involved. I think I've made it pretty clear by now that I think a standard random encounter is pretty boring. So we want to take this encounter and tie it into a larger narrative. Let's say the players are on their way to a new town and this encounter is going to happen on the road to that town to serve as an introduction to the next story arc. But before we can make our encounter narratively meaningful, we need to have a vague idea of how it's going to fit into the wider story. The town the players are heading to, Connington, recently had an election where Mayor Clementine Garin was re-elected. Shortly after the election, a local man named Carrick ran through the streets raving about Garin being a devil. When the town guard tried to stop him, he killed a guard and fled into the woods. Since then, Carrick has been recruiting people and he and his wildlings have been raiding the town and abducting travellers. This gives us our context for this encounter. Carrick's wildlings are going to try and abduct the players, but why? Their goal can't just be to abduct the players, there needs to be something deeper to their meaning. But it turns out that Carrick isn't the raven lunatic the town had branded him at all. He really did see the mayor consorting with devils. His wildlings are townsfolk who he's convinced, and together they're working to defeat the mayor. The reason why these wildlings are abducting people from the road is to bring them to Carrick so he can make his case before they're influenced by the mayor. So that gives us an idea of what the narrative weight of this encounter is, and we know what the goals of our enemies are: abduct the players and bring them to Carrick. So now let's look at how we can make the fight mechanically interesting. We'll start off by thinking about variety. Now this will be a fairly low level encounter, so we can't use any crazy creature types, but that doesn't mean we can't make things interesting with some variety in our enemies. The basic bandit is pretty boring, they have a scimitar or a light crossbow, but we can do a lot better than that. Thinking about the unit types in 4th edition for example, we want some different roles including soldier, artillery, brute and skirmisher. Starting with our soldiers, we'll use the standard bandit profile, but we'll swap out that scimitar for a club. After all, we don't want to try and kill the heroes, we want to knock them unconscious and take them to Carrack. Next we have our artillery. Now firing arrows at the players doesn't seem to really further our enemy's goals of abducting them, so how can the archers contribute to that goal? Well, one option is that they could have arrows dipped in paralyzing poison. Anytime one of the archers does damage to a player, the player needs to make a con save or be paralyzed. We'd make the DC for this pretty low because we don't want to wipe out the party this way, but it'd be another element in the tension of the scene. If the players know that the arrows are poisoned, they're more likely to stay in cover and use the terrain elements to their advantage. If we keep thinking about our enemy's goals to incapacitate the party and drag them away, we need to adjust how we think of the brute. Usually this is a tanky monster that does a lot of damage, but that doesn't work for our purposes, so instead we want to focus not on the damage, but instead on the defense. Our brute could be a wildling carrying a huge wooden tower shield. We'll keep the stats of the regular bandit, but bump its AC up by 2 for the shield. This enemy is just going to be there to kind of shield the soldier units, so we want to change their attack from a scimitar to a shield bash. Just D4 bludgeoning damage is fine for this, nothing crazy, but it'll help chip away at the players. And finally, we want some skirmishers in this fight. Again, we're going to use that basic bandit profile as our base because I really want to show you that you don't need to use crazy powerful or unusual monsters to make combat more interesting. All you need is a few tweaks here and there and you end up with a much more interesting combat. So the point of the skirmishers is to harass the players, dipping into and out of combat freely and using their maneuverability to target the player's weak spots. Keeping in mind our enemy's goal to abduct the players, we want to give these skirmishers nets to be able to restrain the players. Now before we can talk tactics for our enemy, we need to understand our terrain, the environment of our encounter. This encounter is going to take place on a road that's going through a forest. We want one side of the road to be a hill with an elevated position in the trees, and the other side of the road to be a dense thicket of bushes with a lot of uneven ground. As the player's caravan moves through the forest, our bandits are going to roll a burning cart down the hill, blocking the road before they emerge from both sides of the road to ambush the players. We don't need a dialogue encounter here. Carrick knows it's easier to have a conversation with the players if they're bound and can't reach their weapons, so the wildlings aren't attempting to talk to the players here. The road itself will be standard terrain, but the dense lowered portion and the tree-covered hill will grant various cover to our bandits. For the enemy tactics, our archers will be up on the hill using their trees for cover, and in the first round or two before the players can get into their own cover, the archers will be a huge threat, especially with those saves to avoid paralysis. The soldiers and the brutes will come from both sides of the road and try and funnel the players together so they can surround them. And finally, the skirmishers will arrive on the second or third turn of combat and use part of their movement to emerge from tunnels they've dug in the dense undergrowth. This will get them close to the players so they can throw their nets and then vanish back into the tunnels for a few rounds before coming back to try again. Having the skirmishers emerge, attack, and then vanish every couple of rounds adds another layer of tension to the combat because the players are never going to know when they'll next be attacked or really how many enemies they're fighting. But of course, we want some kind of event or twist for the encounters so that in the middle portion of the battle, where things start to naturally get dull and drag, we can reinvigorate the combat and pull the players' focus back in. Now we're going to do this by having the flaming cart that the wildlings use to stop the players explode halfway through the battle. This will have a small area of effect and a little bit of damage, but the main reason we want to do this is once the cart explodes, the battlefield will be covered in a thick blanket of smoke. Maybe we could have the players have some constitution saves to avoid coughing fits, but the main goal here is to change the status quo. The enemy archers will no longer be able to target the players, but the frontline enemies, who know the terrain far better than our players, will be at a serious advantage. Perception checks will help our players pick out the sound of the enemies approaching, but during this section of the battle, it's the skirmishers who will become the real threat. Emerging from unseen tunnels and approaching in silence, the skirmishers will be able to get close and try and net the players in relative safety. If a player gets netted during the section, the enemy could quickly bound them before their next turn and attempt to carry them off. The tension for the players would be huge if they could hear their comrade being taken through the smoke and have to rely on their non-visual senses to give chase. And finally, we need to decide on how our enemy is going to react to the tide turning in this fight. These wildlings aren't interested in fighting to the death, so if the players kill a couple of them, they will withdraw, reposition, and strike out again rather than stay in the thick of the action. The tunnels in the lowlands would be perfect for the skirmishers and some of the soldiers to retreat into, and the brutes and remaining soldiers could flee up the hill under the cover of the archer fire. When you combine all these elements with encouraging your players to narrate their attacks and use their creativity to come up with new and interesting actions in combat, you take what was once the most boring possible premise that you can run as a DM and turn it into something really spectacular that the players will remember. Instead of a boring encounter where the players hit some bandits until they die, we have this narratively significant encounter with a variety of enemy types that work together in interesting ways and a shifting battlefield that changes the circumstances of the fight over time. I guarantee that if you ran this as an opening encounter for a new campaign, your players would vastly prefer it to the standard ambush encounter we've seen 100 times before. One thing my players have been really interested in lately is crafting, making potions and concoctions to help them fight monsters out in the world, or crafting new weapons and armors. So I'm really pleased that today's episode is sponsored by Kibble's Compendium of Craft and Creation. This supplement is fully 5e compatible and contains a whole new crafting system which covers everything from blacksmithing, alchemy, and even enchanting wondrous items. But that's not all, there's also 12 new subclasses as well as 2 new full classes. The Scion, who uses the magic of the mind to bend reality, and the Inventor, which is like an artificer with even more options. There are also new monsters, spells, new magic items, and a whole bunch more. This book really is jam-packed with content, and it's perfect for expanding the options in your games beyond the core 5th edition books. All the material in the book is based on years of design and thousands of hours of playtesting done by the Kibble's Tasty community, and the Kickstarter is already fully funded and has started smashing through loads of stretch goals already, including more races and subclasses. The Kibble's Compendium of Craft and Creation is available as a physical book or as a PDF, and you can also pick up the class handbooks and the crafting compendium on their own if that's all you're interested in. The project is running until February the 4th and you can check it out using the link in the description below. And thanks again to Kibble's Tasty for supporting the channel and the content that I make. I really hope this video has helped you think more deeply about the elements of combat and how you can make small changes that have big impacts on how engaging a combat is. And if you've got any of your own tips for making combats more engaging and interesting, I'd love to hear them down in the comments below. But until next time, happy gaming.